Okay. I'm John Mack. This is the panel on anti-Sovietism in America. What are its sources? A large topic. I wanted to say that this particular panel is co-sponsored by the Center for Psychological Studies in the Nuclear Age. Rita Rogers, who's also on the panel, is a member of the advisory board, and I'm the academic director of the center. I think the genius of this conference is that it takes a subject which has, until quite recently, represented the eye through which many, if not most, Americans see the world. And when you want to bring about a political, psychological, or scientific shift, it's necessary to bring the context or the eye through which we perceive into the clearing so it itself can be perceived. When we look at the ideologies through which we examine the world, we begin to shift, and when we shift, we begin to open up our consciousness to expand what's possible for us to see, and then we can begin to experience and see the problems that exist in the world beyond our own narrow perception of them. We begin to care more, and we can become more committed in a deeper, broader sense. As we've heard in this conference, anti-communism in America has become a kind of national official ideology. It's used to justify militarism, and it's used to avoid virtually all the major reality problems that we need to face. Almost any kind of movement towards social change, economic, political, the search for social justice, the concern for people less advantaged, can be labeled as a communist conspiracy or a communist interest. I had a unique experience along these lines. I didn't think that was possible last month. I went to a conference at Findhorn, that incredible community which is attempting to address global problems in a new, humanly connected way. It's in northern Scotland. If you saw my dinner with Andre, Andre Gregory talked about Findhorn in a way that transformed the way he looked at the world. And the title of the conference was "The Individual and the Collective: Politics as if the Whole Earth Mattered." What a wonderful title, and which brought forth many discussions about the environment and ecology and what the political and economic system was doing to the planet. And so, fresh with enthusiasm, I came to Paris and was with some friends, and a psychologist there said, well, that's part of the green movement, isn't it? And the whole ecology movement, the environment, isn't that a communist conspiracy to control our minds? And I said, no, it's about the environment. We're all poisoned. Look at Paris itself. You can't breathe in this city. You know, you're all going to die of what my barber calls drowning in our industrial feces. And no, this is a communist plot to have us worried about being poisoned by the environment. So I'd never heard that before, and I haven't heard that in America yet, but I assume if it started in Paris, where fashions maybe begin, we'll soon have that in America. How deep this communist structural, anti-communist structural ideology is was brought to my attention in a new way by Roberta Snow, who has several distinctions in addition to being president of the founding president of ESR. She's also the wife of our distinguished panelist on the left. And Bobby brought to my attention a Florida state mandate that requires 30 hours of teaching about communism to all students in the Florida schools. And it stresses that these courses should be the way of meeting the challenge of communism and informing students, quote, as to the evils, dangers, and fallacies of communism by giving them a thorough understanding of the entire communist movement, including its history, doctrines, objectives, and techniques. The course, the document went on to say, shall lay particular emphasis upon the dangers of communism, the ways to fight communism, the evils of communism, the fallacies of communism, and the false doctrines of communism. And it concludes, no teacher or textual material assigned to the course shall present communism as preferable to the system of constitutional government and the free enterprise competitive economy indigenous to the United States, end quote. Now, Harvey Cox, in a previous panel this morning, called to our attention the fact that if we're going to move into something that's going to combat this kind of deep structural, ideological, not only rhetoric, but really raison d'etre of our society, then we're going to have to come up with new ideas, new myths, new symbols, new ways of embracing the world we live in that can inspire and grow, lead us to grow beyond this way of looking at things. Now, each speaker on the panel today has many unique features, but they have one particular quality which I especially appreciate as a psychologist, psychiatrist, psychoanalyst, whatever, and that is that when they look at the problem of anti-Sovietism, they look at it from the standpoint of what there is about ourselves and our society that creates the way we look at this problem. First speaker is George Perkovich on my left. I don't know quite how to introduce George. I think George is a journalist, a writer, much more. We call him a rising Sovietologist. He probably wouldn't consider himself a psychologist, and yet in his writings he has a particular sensitivity to the human and psychological dimensions of the political issues that he looks at. He's going to talk with us today about the question of the need for an enemy reversing the equation. In other words, do we need the Soviet Union as an enemy to justify deterrence and the whole political and economic structure that undergirds it? George.
What I want to do is to outline how the military strategy of nuclear deterrence requires and perpetuates the sort of pathological, unstudied anti-Sovietism that appears in American public opinion and among many of the American political elite. And I want to distinguish that sort of anti-Sovietism from what one might have if one studied and traveled in the Soviet Union or other communist states. I mean, the point of the anti-Sovietism that we're talking about here is that it's reactionary in the kind of the medical sense of the term. And before I do that, two prefatory notes. One is that much of what I have to say draws on the work of a man named Michael McGuire at the Brookings Institution. He's a former British naval officer who specializes in the Soviet military, and he's written extensively on some of the points that I'm talking about here, and so I would urge you to seek out his work. The second point is the chicken and egg problem. It's hard to say whether our pathological anti-Sovietism led to our heavy reliance and internalization of deterrence theory, or whether, in fact, the military strategy came first and then required or led into the sort of anti-Sovietism that we have. In any case, the distinction isn't that important now because you can see that the two are interdependent and linked with each other at the present time. You can't have deterrence as we have it without having a sort of kind of vitriolic anti-Sovietism. Okay, so what is the essence of nuclear deterrence theory? And why do I say it contributes necessarily to anti-Sovietism? Well, strategic nuclear arsenals number over 25,000 today, and there's little reason to think that if any of them is used, the result will be less than the annihilation of Europe, most probably the superpowers, and depending on what you believe about nuclear winter, the globe. So in other words, nuclear deterrence means that we tell the Soviet Union that we're willing to destroy them and probably ourselves in order to keep them from attacking Europe or us in the first place. This is MAD, which is the acronym, And there have been attempts to escape it, most recently with SDI, but the reality is that, that theory operates. But obviously, for such a suicidal strategy to make sense and to persuade publics to support it politically and fiscally requires that we think certain things about the people we're deterring. The first thing we have to think about the Soviet Union is that they are so evil that it's worth it for us to kill them, even if we ourselves will be killed in the process. Better dead than red is the slogan that sort of epitomizes this psychology. And it's, it may appear laughable at times, but I think it is a slogan that a lot of people believe, especially if you watch cable TV, which I happen to a lot, and you see a lot of these talk shows, and it comes up over and over again. And it's nothing sort of a suspension of rational calculation. And that is one of the mental processes that's required for nuclear deterrence. The second and related assumption of deterrence theory is that the enemy, in fact, intends to attack us, that without our deterrent, the Soviets would take over the world. This urge to take over the world is presumed to be so innate in communists that political, economic, or even a slightly less numerous nuclear arsenal is not adequate to forestall it. And thus, the often heard claim, and you heard it a lot around the signing of the INF Treaty, is that nuclear deterrence has preserved the peace in Europe for 40 years. Well, that statement, first of all, can't be proved, but in order to believe that statement, you had to assume in the first place that the Soviets wanted to attack Western Europe and would have done so in the last 40 years were it not for those weapons. And again, that's an assumption that's central to deterrence. You can trace this notion of Soviet intentions back to NSC 68, which is a national security document written in 1950, primarily by Paul Nitze, who's now and has been for a long time kind of the leading arms control official in the United States. And what that document said, it was secret, it was written to President Truman. What it said was this. This is a quote. "The Soviet Union, unlike previous aspirants to hegemony, is animated by a new fanatic faith, antithetical to our own, and seeks to impose its absolute authority over the rest of the world." The document then goes on to say that the task of the U.S. must be to contain this lust for new territory in the Soviet Union, and that superior military strength is what's required to accomplish this containment. And in defense, I mean, there's little doubt that this vision of the Soviet Union grew out of the then recent experience of World War II. In other words, the Soviets kind of became the Nazis, became Hitler, which is kind of a familiar pattern in defense theory. In other words, you plan the new war as if it were the last war. And so right after World War II, the notion becomes, well, the next enemy is going to be just like the Nazis, and therefore we have to plan accordingly. Yet, lest the assumption that the Soviets intend to take over the world seem outdated, here's what the new chief of naval operations, Admiral Carlisle Trost, said in 1987. He said, "Our interests are being contested by a confederation of powers whose highest priority is to replace all free and democratic societies with totalitarian states." To reiterate this first part, in order for deterrence theory to work, the Soviets must be seen as evil and must have the most diabolical urges if we're to feel comfortable with a military strategy that virtually guarantees the destruction of our own selves in the course of punishing them. A second stage of the deterrence anti-communism relationship occurs when military force planners actually go to work and the procurement process starts to operate. Taking Soviet evil intentions as a given, military planners think solely about military capabilities. What do the Soviets have in terms of forces on the ground? What are the destructive capabilities of those forces on the ground? And these capabilities are then always seen and interpreted in the worst case context. Michael McGuire calls this the colonel's fallacy. The colonel's job is properly to prepare to defeat the worst case. His job is to figure out what's the worst thing the enemy can do, and then how do I stop that? The colonel's job isn't to ask, well, what do the Soviet political leaders really have in mind? Why do they have those weapons? How do the Soviets see the world? That's fine. The fallacy is that political leaders and foreign policy makers don't have the same responsibility as the colonel. Their job should not be to dwell on worst-case thinking and on capabilities alone, but rather they need to consider what are the most probable crises from which conflict could result, what are the most probable scenarios that we face, and more importantly, what is possible, how might we avoid war in the first place. That's what they're paid for. Yet what happens is our political leaders begin to adopt the colonel's approach, and that leads to the sort of worst-case military thinking. And this is all the flip side, this disposition of political leaders is kind of a flip side of the already present assumptions about Soviet intentions. In other words, nobody at any point is now thinking about what the Soviets are really up to. It's all kind of extrapolations based on our own assumptions. Several additional facets of modern political life exacerbate these tendencies, and they're obvious and don't require much elaboration. One is the need to hype the threat in order to win budgets, and there are plenty of quotes that I'm sure we all have that you know reveal this. And another tendency is kind of the militarization of American politicians and pundits. And I mean that kind of the intellectual militarization. I mean, you don't get elected if you don't prove that you're tough and very familiar with military strategy and demonstrate in debates that you think as a military strategist as opposed perhaps to, say, a diplomat. There's a footnote to that which would be Reykjavik, and maybe we could talk about that during the questions. Now, the basic consequence of thinking that your adversary in his core, essentially, desires to attack you and that your mission is to contain him is that you will always be engaged in a negative campaign. You'll always be blocking him, deterring him, scaring him, frightening him, threatening him, but it's always a negative activity. And to be on the safe side, and because at every level of analysis you assume the worst case, you wind up with a psychological and physical overkill. Moreover, that the mindset of always negating or blocking leads us to dismiss quickly, as at Reykjavik, for example, any positive notions that both parties could pursue cooperation or that both have a national interest in scaling back forces. We put little stock in establishing political avenues to avoid misunderstandings and crises. Now, all of this, or rather, there would be little point for critiquing all of this and for critiquing nuclear deterrence if the strategy and its underlying notions about the Soviet Union actually corresponded to reality. In other words, if it were true that the Soviets did desire to take over Europe and the world, and if the only thing keeping the Soviets from going to war with us is our nuclear weapons, then our current strategy and posture make a certain amount of sense. Yet, as I said earlier, the producers of deterrence theory don't study that. They don't ask that question. It's all assumed from the beginning. And the point of this critique and the reason that I'm here making these criticisms is that, in fact, the Soviets don't have those aspirations and haven't historically demonstrated the patterns of behavior that we attribute to them. And here again, I follow Mike McGuire's research, which I highly recommend in its kind of historical patterns. The Soviets don't have an interest in taking over Europe, and historically they've preferred to avoid crises rather than rely on their or our capacities to manage them. One of the common reasons given for Khrushchev's ultimate demotion, as it were, is that the Cuban Missile Crisis, that he got into a situation that scared the hell out of these very control-obsessed people in the Politburo. And that pattern and obsession with control and kind of aversion to risk, runs through the Soviet system, at least in the past. Today, obviously you see either in pronouncements by Defense Minister Yazov and Gorbachev and others, that Soviet military doctrine deems that avoiding war, not deterring it, not stopping the hostile West with superior forces, but avoiding war in the first place, is the highest objective of the military. You read new Soviet military pronouncements, the instructions given to generals and so on, is that the point is war is no longer inevitable, and that it need not be nuclear or global if it occurs. for example, in the Persian Gulf. And so that the opportunity and the challenge is to avoid war and thereby save the Soviet Union in crisis. And this military doctrine today explains the recent initiatives by Gorbachev in all facets of arms control and diplomacy, the INF treaty being one, proposals strategic weapons being another. Soviet eagerness to get started on reducing conventional forces in Europe is another example. The efforts to end the conflict in Angola and Cambodia, Afghanistan, these all kind of flow out of this notion that, that war must be avoided, it doesn't do them any good, and that it's possible to scale back. So in this Soviet thinking, there's an opportunity to pursue an alternative framework for U.S. and global security. Such a framework would involve deep reduction and restructuring of conventional forces, and it would preclude surprise attack or short warning offensives. It would also involve deep cuts in strategic nuclear forces, partly out of the gut feeling that they're useless and psychologically debilitating to people all around the world, and partly out of fear that with so many of the weapons and so many plans for their use, that there's too great a temptation in defense circles that they would be fired by accident or else in a crisis in war. However, in my opinion, this doesn't mean that all nuclear weapons would be eliminated. For several sound reasons, it's wise or necessary that several hundred, let's say, invulnerable warheads will remain between the superpowers. These weapons would constitute, or reflect rather, the inescapable existential deterrence that nuclear technology itself constitutes. But the huge difference between this sort of posture and the system that we have today founded on nuclear deterrence is that it would reflect the realization by both superpowers that military competition and warfare are so clearly not in their interest that they are determined to avoid it. This determination would be signified by profoundly reduced forces and their clear defensive posture. It would be quite unlike the system we have today, which is poised to strike at a given instant with obviously offensive overkill. I'll stop here. The logical next step would be to explore politically, the steps towards realizing such kind of a scaling down of military forces and the sort of anti-communism that goes with them. But I just want to say that the anti-Sovietism and the military forces we have are so intertwined that it's doubtful you can reduce one without the other.
Thank you, George. At a conference in about 1984, John Steinbrenner, who's a political analyst, said in a candid moment in Washington, it's worth your cost you your political life if you acknowledge that the Soviet intentions are less evil than the common wisdom declares. Our next speaker is Dr. Rita Rogers, who is clinical professor of psychiatry, child psychiatrist at UCLA. It's a little tricky for me to introduce Dr. Rogers since we are co-authors of a book which concerns her life. Her life, I think, gives her a particularly interesting perspective for her remarks this afternoon. She has the somewhat unique historical experience of having been a prisoner and escaped from both the Nazi regimes and three communist regimes during the 1940s, periods of the war, and the years post-war. Dr. Rogers has been one of those unusual people who has come out of the Eastern European experience. I guess I would consider Dr. Lown another one of those unique people. Rather than experiencing the kind of hostility and hatred and projective mechanisms that Joel Covell talked about in this morning's panel, have worked. How they do it, I don't quite know. What differentiates the people that do this, that is to transcend that experience and work toward global cooperation, collaboration, and those that end up using their experience at the hands of oppressive political regimes to deepen the hatred and to pursue policies of projection and hatred. What differentiates those two groups is a subject that fascinates me, but in any event, Rita is one of those unusual people who has transcended her experience to move toward a global vision. She is going to speak with us this afternoon about fears of the Soviet Union and how those fears affect our political attitudes. Rita.
Thank you very much. I was very honored by the invitation and grateful to John and the Center for inviting me. I was tremendously honored when I realized that I will be able to sit next to Professor Bernard Lown, whom I had seen at the first conference of the International Physicians at Arley House. So any shortcomings in my presentation, we will in psychiatric fashion ascribe to this excitement about sitting here. I will talk to you neither as a communist nor an anti-communist, but only as a psychiatrist, since this is my only qualification. And fear of this, about fears of the Soviet Union, and will preface it that my presentation is subjective and very, very subjective. Now, memories and perceptions in general create for us a prism through which we see the world. Our actions reflect very much our bounded reality, namely how we integrate in ourselves both the amalgamation of past and present experiences, how these intertwine with external and internal realities. And we constantly attempt to create a match between external and internal realities. And when this doesn't quite work, we are always willing to give in favor of our internal realities and make them fit. Now, when there are problems where we cannot by any means establish a fit with that, we experience anxiety, but in anxiety, which is an unconscious phenomenon, we do not know of what we are afraid, and in lay words, it is best described as a fear of being afraid. But in fears, we operate completely different. With fears, we always try and attempt to develop clear-cut maps of the boundaries. And in order to simplify that, we are very tempted to establish boxes, a white one, a black one. And of course, we place our contribution to any relationship which is fear of which we are afraid. Our contributions get constantly whitened, while those of the opponent get blackened, so that gradually the opponent becomes the enemy. Now, fears get much galvanized when they intermix with what we call archaic fears, fears of desertion, loss of love, body harm. Fears also get galvanized, though, by some of us who integrate into our selfhood, our country, our nation, and so that we perceive anything which we perceive as a threat towards it becomes intertwined with a danger to our selfhood. And this gets markedly aggravated when there is a feeling, when memories of childhood fears, of archaic fears, get mixed into it. One can see that when there is this kind of feeling, we also feel very disappointed that we haven't been more vigilant in observing the opponent who has become the enemy. It is therefore, for instance, an example that When President Carter, when after the invasion of Afghanistan, President Carter's reaction to canceling the Olympic Games in Moscow, the participation of the U.S. participation in the Olympic Games, was also a reaction to the feeling of having skipped an observation and being surprised by something which one should have been vigilant for, which he considered. Now, in assessment of fears, it is very important to be able to understand also the fears of the opponent, of the counterpart. And that is a very, very difficult task, because most people are not aware of their own fears. So to be able to assess the vulnerabilities of the opponent, and in fact, to consider that the vulnerabilities of the opponent, if one understands them and takes them into consideration, that they can be used towards improving one's own security is a concept which it has now advanced from MAD to the concept of common security, namely perceiving that the opponent's increased security will provide and can provide a nation's increased security. Now, it is important to realize, and here I quote Bialer, who criticizes very much that one should not consider the conflict between the Soviet Union and the United States as a pure psychological. He ascribes it to a conflict of values which is projected onto a global interests and translated into national interests. However, like McGeorge Bundy said, the wars do not start in warheads, but in heads. And values are a psychological issue. And besides, even if one does not want to psychologize the entire problem, one has to consider psychological issues because they increase the virulence of the conflict. They decrease reality perception. They create false illusions, followed by backlash. They can create stagnation. Now, the background of this Cold War, of this fearful relationship between the Soviet Union and United States, is ascribed by different authors to different stages. Some ascribe it to the Truman Doctrine, and to the shearing up of anti-communist forces in Turkey and Greece. Others ascribe it to George Kennan's long cable where he recommended containment. However, fear is also a very successful tool in creating alliances. A historian from Emory University, Harvard, for instance, claims that Winston Churchill's talk in Fulton, Missouri, I think it was February 1946, was used really as a way of transforming the Soviet-British antagonism which existed in regards to influence in Iran, Turkey, and Greece, namely that the British considered this their sphere of influence, that Winston Churchill was trying really to create a US Soviet confrontation in spirit and an alignment between Britain and the United States. Because in those days, the United States, right after World War II, at the end and the formation of the United Nations, there was an atmosphere of alignment. Now, there are some, and at that time, Winston Churchill used the term Iron Curtain, which he had borrowed from Goebbels, but didn't give it accurate attribution. It was not identified, and he described the world as divided into good and evil, Christian and communist. And however, there are some historians, like Boyle, who does not agree with Harbert's interpretation. He considers rather that Truman has invited the charismatic leader, charismatic orator, as Churchill was, because he felt that Churchill will raise what Truman considered existent in the American psyche, namely virulent anti-communism. Now, there are proofs that indeed some of it exists, and at least the Soviets feel that way. In one interview, Posner, the spokesman, identified, and I have a quote of what he said then, where he seemed to believe very much that this feeling indeed exists. And he stated that in the United States, that there are numerous America has a multitude of diverse radio and television stations, newspapers and magazines. Americans often say that opposing views are freely expressed on the air and in the press. But when the Soviet Union comes up, it sometimes seems as though there is only one broadcasting station, newspaper or magazine. So identical is the image of our country that the various media sketch, Americans have an astonishing stereotyped conception of the Soviet Union. Now, there are numerous misperceptions in the United States. One of them, the comparison of communism with Nazism. Another severe misperception is that the Soviet Union is a status quo power, or on the opposite side, that the Soviet Union has a master plan with a deadline. Another misperception which one encounters very frequently is the idea that the Soviet Union reacts only to what the United States does or says, as if all policy is determined by that, a consideration of Soviet decision makers as cynics and fanatics, and also the...
Couple minutes.
Okay, so if we have only a couple of minutes, I will go to other issues, namely that indeed fear has external and internal aspects. And it is important for us, in a true psychiatric sense, to look also at the other side's contribution. And here, the foreign policy of the Soviet Union has produced many fears. The 1939 absorption of Eastern Poland, the Belorussia, and Bessarabia and Northern Bukovina, without any consideration of the wishes of the people, and at the same time as offering the justification that this is due because they were parts of the Tsarist regime. Also, since 1945, the dictation of power towards the countries of Romania, Bulgaria, Poland, Czechoslovakia, and East Germany. The invitation to Afghanistan, all these have indeed created enormous fears. And the assumptions about it, that there is another plan following. Now, what my predecessor here on the panel said about the military is a very important aspect, namely that the military needs to shear up its budgetary demands by increasing the threat. However, one of the other misperceptions in the United States is to compare the military in the Soviet Union with the one in the United States, because the feeling which the Russian people have for their military as having defended Matryoshka Russia, little Mother Russia, is not something which can be ignored. For them, the military, for the Russian people, the military is us, not they. And that makes a tremendous difference in assessing. Now, for the Westerners, it becomes very difficult to understand the components of patriotism in the Soviet Union, because the roots and the basis of patriotism have old historical roots. And some of them are from the Tsarist regime, some are from the Orthodox Church, and some from the military. Now, if one does not take the trouble to study history, read the literature, and understand the vulnerabilities of their people, then it becomes very confusing to comprehend that a regime which doesn't exist, an atheist state, has remnants in it which need to be kept in consideration. But in general, I would say that the fear between the Soviet Union and the United States has also another profound quality, and that is that Russia evokes in people, by its vastness, its literature, its art, its history, feelings of love or hate. And the Western world is gradually getting very uncomfortable with strengths of such feelings, because they are more disconnected from each other, and the connectedness which exists in that world, which increases passion, is somewhat disturbing. And it therefore raises very great conflicts. I think that in September 1987, there was a panel, Capital to Stolitsa, in which three senators from the United States had a dialogue with three members of the Politburo. And when one heard the dialogue, one heard the mutual fears. One heard the fear of the military people from the Soviet Union talking about SDI, and one heard the fears of the U.S. senators about the conventional forces. One almost saw a re-exacerbation of old fears that hordes will be coming from the East. And I do think that in the assessment of the relationship, there has to be a constant consideration of the vulnerabilities on each side. And unfortunately, the lack of learning which exists in our textbook, the simplification which we get through television does not lend itself towards a better understanding of our own history and vulnerabilities, and even less of those of others. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Rita. Our next speaker really doesn't need an introduction for you. He's well known to you. I just will mention one story that I like to be associated with Dr. Lown, so I will tell you a story also from Airlie House, the first Internet Congress of the International Physicians for the Prevention of Nuclear War, in which we began the process of dissolving our distances with the Soviet Union in vodka. And there was a small group, and I was called upon perhaps inadvisedly, to make a toast. And I don't remember what I said, but I gather that I mixed in vivid terms sexual and political images in the toast. I knew I had said something wrong because the following year, at the second Congress of the International Physicians for the Prevention of Nuclear War in Cambridge, England, Dr. Lown delegated his wife, Louise, to go over to the table at which I was sitting and advise me not to make a toast similar to the one that I had made the previous year at Airlie House. Bernie Lown, I consider one of the people that has done more than anyone to overcome the distortions, the fears, the hatred, the political misuse of the image of the Soviet Union. One of my residents, psychiatric residents at Cambridge Hospital, defined evil as gratuitous disconnectedness. And so I think it is, if that's the case, then certainly doing human good is the overcoming of disconnectedness. So I won't go on. I think you know what's ensued with the International Physicians Movement. It's probably one of the most successful efforts in the world to create some sanity out of the superpower, mad, threatening relationship. Dr. Lown's going to talk with us this afternoon about physicians' experiences with the evil empire. Bernie.
A phenomenal experience of the 1980s was the emergence of an international physicians movement, which continues to grow, has more than 200,000 members in 62 countries, and has had a profound impact, especially on the Soviet Union. In a way, it anticipated this conference, for it was a premature anti-communist movement, not in word, but in deed. It began in the early 1960s when a group of Boston doctors examined the medical effects of a multi-megaton attack against the city. We concluded at the time that there was no rational medical response, and in fact, the facts were chilling and persuasive. There was no place to hide, and it was clear that there was no rational answer to nuclear war other than its prevention. The physicians who started that movement, in a way, were simple-minded do-gooders, reminiscent of the characters of George Bernard Shaw's Major Barbara. They were convinced that exposing the public to the gruesome facts with somber objectivity would induce people to heed their message. Going for that point of view was the most basic of instincts, that of survival. Nothing of the kind happened. Our facts were dismissed not as being false, but worse, as being irrelevant. Since then, as you know, a multi-trillion dollar arms race has ensued with enormous economic cost. We profligately purchased ever-increasing insecurity at an ever more prohibitive price. But why has this madness continued? How is it possible that people would work against not only their economic self-interest, but incredibly against the basic biologic instinct of self-preservation, of the survival of themselves, their families, their community? In no small measure, it relates to what this conference is all about, ideology. Namely, and I reject completely the concept that this is genetic in some way, the victim is responsible, and searching in the victim, because this is a very carefully nurtured public misperception that gained currency by incessant repetition and acquired the steadfastness of a theologic fixation impervious to common sense, to logic, or to exacting scientific analysis. In fact, ideology is now more decisive as a test of reality than truth. Once infected with ideology, consent then can be readily manufactured. It is predictable and it is constantly supportive of establishment values and interests, even if those run contrary to one's self-interest. You are programmed. You do not need a Gauleiter. It is in your brain. And this is what has been achieved in America, and I want to briefly tell you about our experience in the IPPNW. We have aimed, you know, basing ourselves on the fact 20 years of the physicians' movement that we got nowhere. We got nowhere with the bombing rounds and the gruesome facts, because invariably the response to us was what has permeated the peace movement and paralyzed the peace movement in America and paralyzed all progressive movements was what about the Russians? What about communism? In various ways that this was utilized. The aim of IPPNW was to break through that without any ideologic discussions, but rather by developing a citizen diplomacy and thereby cut through the fog of subhuman stereotyping, a demeaning of a nation wherein complex differences between two complex social systems are reduced to merely the combat between forces of good and evil. We assaulted this central ideologic mythology and we got punished. And I want to relate to you the three phases of punishment. The first was the fact that we were rapidly accused of really doing disservice to democracy. I remember the ambassador of the United States in Moscow who said to me that I was really inflicting enormous evil on American society because he says you are disarming the democracies by pointing out the horror of nuclear war and diminishing their resolve to resist communist totalitarianism. This phase, and what he said is you're not talking to the Russians. Despite the fact that the Soviets were publishing a lot of our material right from the very beginning. This came to an abrupt end, this phase, on Saturday night, June 26, 1982, when we addressed 150 million Soviet citizens on primetime television for 1 hour on this issue. Now, what is curious, that broadcast we offered to the major networks in the United States, and it was refused. They didn't even want to see it. Now, this was the first of numerous exposures. Just a month ago, I spoke to 100 million Russians for 45 minutes. Do you realize what 45 minutes being on television means? We have never had that possibility in the United States. Never, never, never. And this is indeed for shame. When I met Mrs. Raisa Gorbachev recently, she said to me, from watching Soviet television, it seems to me as though I have known you for 1,000 years. And indeed, this phase came to an end when we began to address the Soviets and they knew the facts of nuclear war. Phase two was more malignant. It was not based on criticism, but the manufacture of diversion and disinformation. It consisted of a well-coordinated, unrelenting attack to wit that IPPNW was a Soviet stooge. Proof of this thesis is that we ignored the fate of dissidents. Remarkable was the uniformity of the message. It is really startling if you sit at my end and look across the United States how everybody spoke in unison as though goose-stepping. Now, the language, the commonality of language, the similarity of message, whether a small town newspaper or the New York Times, it was widely known that we were a one-issue organization. No similar demands were made on Amnesty International to involve itself in the nuclear issue, or Friends of the Earth to address human rights abrogations. Why pick on a IPPNW for having a singular focus? If the truth be told, by virtue of the enormous prestige and credibility we developed in the Soviet Union, we were responsible for the release of more dissident than any group in the world today. The cacophony of abuse against IPPNW reached a high decibel at the time of the Nobel Peace Prize. The essential thrust that was we were Soviet dupes aiming to disarm the West. And I won't go into the sordid details because those are almost remarkable. And what emerged later is that this was a well-orchestrated NATO activity, carefully conceived, having the German Christian Democrats lead the charge. The current and third phase, and the last phase, in my mind, is the most malignant of all. We are ignored. we are told repeatedly that we are not newsworthy. This is at a time when the media are surfeited with a suffocating trivia and garbage. Let me cite a few of these examples. I'm citing a few of hundreds of examples. In 1983, General Secretary Andropov sent me a message in which he said, "We are ready for acute and radical reductions in nuclear forces." We went to Washington, hired a public relations firm, got exposed to the media, and not a word entered the media. Not one word of that. A year later, during the presidential campaign, to still public disquiet of Reagan administration confrontational policies, when Chernenko used these very words, they were blazoned in the headlines coast to coast. The very same words of Andropov. When IPPNW persuaded the Soviet Union to engage in a unilateral nuclear testing moratorium, which they followed through in 1985, and I have a letter from the Soviet government that say, "We thank you for helping us reach that initiative." That came from Dobrynin on behalf of the Soviet government. It was completely ignored. When in December 1985, I had a three-hour meeting with Gorbachev, one of the first Americans to spend a lot of time with him and sit like that and argue with him on many issues, including Sakharov, I called a press conference in Moscow. There were 200 correspondents there, and they asked me, "When are you going back to the United States?" Every American correspondent from CBS, NBC, ABC, CNN, whatever. I said, "Tomorrow." And I urged my wife not to wear dungarees to face the photo opportunity on arriving in Idlewild. There was nobody there. Nobody was there. When a few days later, a patient of mine is a very distinguished American. When he asked me why I looked so fatigued, and I say, "I'm jet lagged. Where were you? Moscow. What did you do there?" "I saw Gorbachev." He says, "And I saw the Pope." And I say, "Why are you disbelieving?" He says, "I didn't see it in the New York Times, because you say you met with Gorbachev, and very few Americans know him." Later on, when he, at his insistence, with the New York Times and various other newspapers and the networks, came to interview me, the New York Times published nothing, though the correspondent is Fox Butterfield, a very distinguished correspondent in the New York Times. He said, "In 16 years, his stories have not been cut." When I, right here in my hometown, when I approached the Boston Globe recently with a scoop that the Soviet Union has a new Minister of Health, Eugene Chazov, and that I knew certain facts that he told me that billions of rubles are going to go into the health establishment, this was deemed unnewsworthy. When IPPNW is now engaged in launching a satellite for health information to help serve the needs of the South with East-West cooperation, that is deemed unnewsworthy. 1 month ago in Moscow, there was a conference unprecedented of first one in 63 years of 5,000 physicians on restructuring Soviet medicine. It was important enough to have everybody of the Politburo there. Gorbachev, Ligachev, they were sitting right there, and not a word in the American press. And it surprised me. Why was there no coverage of this issue? Because the Russians bared their dirty laundry in public in a way that was hard to take about the inconsistencies, inadequacies, neglect of Soviet health. And I didn't understand it till it became clear to me that what the Soviets were saying is that Chazov has received 196 billion rubles for health. In fact, it's doubled the budget. Now, where do you get so much money? Where? From the military, right. And this was something that could not be told. The worldview that Americans receive is fractured, incomplete, carefully filtered, and not infrequently doctored. In few countries do people share such a consistency of outlook on global issues. I've now circumnavigated the world many, many times on behalf of IPPNW. Irrespective of class or station, ethnic group or religion, the similarity of Weltanschauung is uncanny here. Scratch a truck driver or a Harvard professor right here, and you get the identical response. For example, Russians would long ago have overrun Europe, save for the deterrent power of our nuclear arsenals. Nuclear war is unlikely since neither side would press the button. The Soviets have more nuclear might than the United States. The Warsaw Pact countries are militarily more powerful in conventional forces than NATO. One of the crass lies.